Put this on? No? This goes here? All right, good. Well, welcome, everybody. Thanks, everybody, for coming today. And this is my first and last press conference of my term. So thanks for being here. So we'll see how it goes. Anyway, thank you, everybody, for coming here today. Obviously, we felt as though now I think 7 weeks into my term, it was important that we have briefings on all our key investigations being conducted by the Department of Attorney General in tandem with the Michigan State Police. And I'm very glad that Colonel Joe Gasper could join us here this morning. Thank you for being here. So before we start with the individual investigation updates, let me say that it is actually pretty unusual for the Department of Attorney General to do a mid-investigation update this way. But both Colonel Gasper and I were new to these positions, obviously, and we know how important this work is to the people of the state of Michigan. So with that being said, because these are active investigations, we might not be able to answer all of your questions today, but we'll do our best. And all three of the investigations that we're going to be talking about here today, the Flint water crisis, the Michigan State University Nassar investigation, and the clergy abuse in the Catholic Church investigation. As you know, they all began under my predecessor, but they have not stopped, and they continue. We have a great team of attorneys and law enforcement officers here, and we appreciate in particular the support from Colonel Gasper and from the Michigan State Police. They've given us resources that have been invaluable and that are absolutely necessary to conduct these important investigations. We absolutely could not conduct these investigations without their good work. So, to start with, let's talk a little bit about the Flint investigations. First of all, I think it's important for me to make clear that we have two types of cases that we're handling in this office. So we have 79 civil cases, but at the same time, there are also the criminal cases, eight of which right now are active criminal cases that are pending. I feel strongly, of course, that the people of Flint deserve nothing short of justice, and I know the governor would agree with that assessment. So we're currently in discussions on the civil cases, and we're hopeful we will be able to resolve them and provide justice to the people of Flint. But there was sort of an unusual situation when I came into the office. And for anybody who followed the campaign, you probably know that I was highly critical of the way the criminal investigations were being handled. And when I came in, and I mean before I took office during the transition period, what I learned was that almost no one in the entire office was actually on the criminal side of the investigation. Practically the entire office had been conflicted out because of the civil cases. So the only people at all from this office that were on the criminal side of that wall, the conflict wall, were Attorney General Bill Schuette and his senior advisor, Rusty Hills. And then there was one new investigator who had been brought in and was put on the criminal side, someone named Jeff Sapinko that you'll hear more about. So, you know, as you know, they'd hired a private firm and Todd Flood in order to handle the criminal investigations. And so other than people I've named, there was no one else in the department. So coming in, literally, it was just the one investigator that was left. And, you know, you had a private firm handling these cases and practically no oversight by this office whatsoever. So what I did when I took office is right after I appointed our new Solicitor General, Fadwa Hamoud, she went on the criminal side of the wall, and she's a career prosecutor. She came to us from the Wayne County Prosecutor's Office, where she was a lead attorney. So I made her our lead on the criminal cases and allowed her to build a team of career prosecutors and investigators that would be in-house, that would work for the Department of Michigan Attorney General. And these would have to be new people that came in who were not on, you know, already on the civil side of the conflict wall. Because I felt it was really important for us to have people working on these cases that were actually accountable to this office and accountable directly to the people of this state. Because this, after all, is the people's law firm, right? That's what the Office of Michigan Attorney General is. And so in a minute, Fadwa will have an update on these cases for you, and then she's going to have more information, I know, in the coming weeks, more specifically. But now that she's on board, and I know that we have someone who is very experienced, who can be on that side of the wall, what I've decided to officially do is to join the civil side, where, of course, as I said, we have 79 ongoing cases, including three cases in the United States District Court for the Eastern District of Michigan, one in which there were a consolidated 68 cases of personal injury and property claims, claims of violating the Federal Safe Drinking Water Act, and claims for violating the Federal Individuals with Disabilities Education Act. So from now on, what's going to happen is when there are updates on the criminal cases, that will be Fadwa handling those cases. I will not be a party to that. I will learn what's happening on those cases, frankly, at the same time that all of you do. And I will only be privy to the things that are public information. So if you have any questions about that, you'll be able to talk to Fadwa and her team. And then, of course, as I said, I'll be on the civil side, and I'll be active in the negotiations that are taking place on those cases. But for right now, I'd like to have Fadwa Hamoud come up and give everybody a brief update on what's happening on the criminal cases. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. As Solicitor General, I am proud to be here alongside Attorney General Dana Nessel and a stellar team of dedicated public servants representing the people of Michigan. And as lead attorney of the Flint water crisis, I'm especially proud to be representing the people of Flint. Prior to taking the lead on the civil cases related to the crisis, as you just heard, Attorney General Nessel made sure that our office is well-equipped and laser-focused on handling the criminal cases, and I am grateful to her for her thoughtful vision and for her leadership, and I believe she has positioned our teams well to ensure that justice is served. I have two items that I would like to discuss today. First, I am pleased to announce that Wayne County Prosecutor Kim Worthy will be working with me jointly as we build out a team that will include experienced prosecutors, career prosecutors, and certified law enforcement officers to investigate and prosecute the Flint water crisis cases. Attorney General Nessel had asked Prosecutor Worthy to join the team out of respect for her expertise and her reputation. I share that respect. I trust Prosecutor Worthy, and I am honored to work alongside someone who I just know to be of the highest integrity in the pursuit of justice for the people of the state. Second, as you also just heard, under the previous administration, Attorney General Bill Schuette had directed an outside firm to lead the prosecutions. Attorney General Nessel and I are bringing the power back to the people by making sure that the leadership of the Flint water crisis cases comes directly from this office. With that said, I am sincerely grateful to all of the people who have worked on this case thus far, but this case is about the people of Flint, and this case should be led by the People's Law Firm. Public leadership on the investigative side also includes my appointment of Special Agent Jeff Sapinko as the office's in-house chief investigator on the criminal cases. A veteran of these cases who has served as the only certified law enforcement official assigned to them thus far, I trust that with his leadership and that his leadership will be critical for strengthening the investigative team on this case. Public leadership will also mean that moving forward, Attorney Todd Flood will now serve the office of the Attorney General in the capacity of Assistant Attorney General on the Flint water crisis cases. Mr. Flood brings 3 years of valuable institutional knowledge, commitment, and relationships from his tenure as the special prosecutor on these cases. I appreciate his work and his team's work on these cases thus far, and I look forward to the contributions that he will make to the team of experienced and career prosecutors that our office is assembling with the help of Prosecutor Kim Worthy. Prosecutor Worthy and I will hold a press conference in the upcoming future to keep you updated on our progress and introduce the team. I'd like to close by reiterating that I am under no illusion about the amount of work that we have ahead of us. I will also be doing additional outreach to engage survivors of this crisis and will, as well as community stakeholders. I come into this role with concern for the victims of the public health crisis in the city of Flint. And my only preconceived notion deals with whether or not the people of Flint were wronged here. They were. The people of Flint were wronged. I do not have preconceived notions about who must be charged, and I am faithfully allowing the evidence to guide our team's work. The Attorney General and I believe that justice needs to be served and that everyone, regardless of their title, is equal under the law, and no one is above the law. Thank you.
Thanks, Badwa. Okay, so now we're going to switch gears and talk about our work on the MSU investigation. First, the report that former Special Independent Counsel William Forsyth issued at the end of last year was very comprehensive, but as noted, would require some additional work before it could be completed. And as he noted, our department was asked by the MSU Board of Trustees to conduct an in-depth investigation into MSU's handling of the Nassar scandal more than a year ago. Now, as a result, three individuals were charged with crimes and have pending court dates, and those are former MSU President Luana K. Simon, former MSU College of Osteopathic Medicine Dean William Strample, and former MSU gymnastics coach Kathy Klages. In addition, as many of you know, yesterday we served administrative complaints in tandem with our partners at the Michigan Department of Licensing and Regulatory Affairs to two MSU athletic trainers, Destiny Teachner Hawk and Liana Haddon, who are alleged to have given false statements to investigators about their knowledge of sexual abuse of students by Nassar. Full and complete cooperation of MSU, frankly, continues to be a challenge. And the irony, of course, is that the trustees themselves are the ones who asked for the investigation, and yet they have made the work of our department extraordinarily difficult. Now, as you know, we are seeking an interview with then-interim president John Engler before he resigned. And following his resignation, I wrote a letter to then-MSU attorney Bob Young requesting the following. I requested an interview with John Engler, whose contract with MSU requires him to, and I'll quote, respond and provide information, end quote, regarding matters within his knowledge even after his employment with the university was concluded. Now, that interview is not yet scheduled, although we have spoken to John Engler's attorney numerous times in an effort to set it up. We can also confirm that we have requested and received documents related to former trustee George Perlis and the alleged forgiveness of a debt owed by him to the university in exchange for his agreement to resign from the board. Do you need to get that? Okay. In exchange for his agreement to resign from the board prior to January so that then Governor Snyder could appoint a replacement. So we are looking into that, and we are also continuing to review the remaining documents that we have from MSU related to this investigation. And as you know, some of our remaining document review was related to documents that MSU claimed were privileged and were being reviewed by the court because of that claim. And so the math here is a little important, so let me briefly review it, the status of those MSU documents that we requested. Now, MSU disclosed that they had withheld or redacted about 7,500 documents, and then we went to court to seek those documents. And that matter is assigned to East Lansing District Court Judge Richard Ball, who said he would review the privileged documents. MSU then voluntarily produced about 1,000 of those documents. Of the almost 6,500 documents remaining, the judge determined that 177 of them were not privileged and should go to the Attorney General. MSU then objected and complained that 29 of those 177 documents should still be either redacted or withheld. Judge Ball then took a look at those 29 documents again, and now with his review complete, it doesn't look like this office will be receiving any more additional documents. So the bottom line is this. Of the more than 7,500 documents that MSU initially withheld or redacted heavily, we are never going to see at least 6,000, if not more, of those. And they have fought us on this, and they fought this office pretty much every step of the way on that. So I can say at this point, this office has done everything we can to try to force the university to be as transparent as possible, but there's really only so much we can do without the university's cooperation. And, you know, now I would say it's time for Michigan State University to do the right thing. Our goal here is to help provide justice and also to provide a sense of security in that something like this will never and can never happen again. And I would really sincerely hope that the Board of Trustees would agree that that is the most important thing. And it was my hope that the new board members and the new interim president would live up to their pledge of cooperation. And I'm still hopeful that that will happen. If MSU really wants to get to the root of the problem, it must right the ship. And it would make sense for the MSU Board of Trustees to waive that privilege and to produce the information that we have consistently sought out, not just the documents that they want us to be able to see. And I would like to remind the board of their fiduciary obligation to the people of this state. That means that the Board of Trustees has an obligation to act in the best interests of the people of this state, not MSU's donors and not its brand image. At the very least, the individual members of the Board of Trustees really should take a look at those 6,000 plus pages of documents to see if they think there's something that the public deserves to know. And finally, I want to thank the hard work of Colonel Gasper's team and also the Eaton County Sheriff. Now, we've sat down, we've had lengthy discussions with Eaton County Prosecutor Doug Lloyd, and we've mutually decided that our office will now take on the investigation of gymnastics coach John Gettard. Now, Gettard founded Twisters, the gymnastics training center where Larry Nassar assaulted many of his victims. And Prosecutor Lloyd recognized that the relationships that this office has with the Nassar survivors and the Eaton County prosecutor thought it only made sense that the investigation come to the AG's office. So we will be handling that. And this particular investigation will be led by our newly appointed career prosecutor, Danielle Hageman-Clark. If you don't mind standing up for a second, Danielle. She's here with us today. She brings with her 20 years of experience prosecuting criminal sexual conduct cases and also homicide cases. As one of our state's leading prosecutor on sexual assault crimes, and if I can say, we worked together for many years at the Wayne County Prosecutor's Office. She was in the Homicide Division, and she was head of the Sexual Assault Unit there. Danielle has prosecuted many high-profile serial rapist cases. She most recently worked at the Prosecuting Attorneys Association of Michigan, training people on these cases, training people around the state. And I know she also worked on the rape kits in Wayne County. So she brings with her a vast amount of experience. I think she's going to be a valuable resource to our team, and she's going to be playing a key role in both the MSU investigation and also the Catholic Church clergy abuse investigation, as well as, I said, the Gettard investigation. So we welcome her, and thank you for finally ceding to my many weeks of begging you to come to this office. Your work is going to be greatly appreciated. So that is going to conclude our remarks on MSU And now I'm going to move on to our third investigation involving Catholic Church clergy abuse. So, to the best of my knowledge, this office, I don't think, has talked very much about our ongoing investigation into Michigan's seven Catholic dioceses. So let me bring you up to speed on this. In October, simultaneous raids were executed at all seven dioceses: Detroit, Saginaw, Lansing, Marquette, Gaylord, Kalamazoo, and Grand Rapids. And that involved nearly 70 officers and special agents, mostly state police, and 14 assistant attorneys general who assisted the officers during the execution of those search warrants. Michigan is the first state to execute a statewide search warrant and was on site to collect the materials deemed relevant to the investigation. We did not depend on the diocese to turn over documents, which is what primarily happened in other states. So as a result of that search, our team seized and is now continuing to review hundreds of thousands of pages of documents, including procedures for receiving and investigating allegations of abuse by the church. Our investigative team has met or spoken with the lawyers representing each of the Michigan seven dioceses. We sent a letter to every parish in the state asking them to inform their parishioners of this investigation. Now, as of this date, we've received more than 300 tips through our clergy abuse hotline, an online tip form, and there are tips being investigated right now for potential criminal prosecution. So what we're doing is we're strongly urging victims or anyone who knows of a victim to contact the state's team of certified law enforcement investigators by calling this number. It's up there. 1-844-324-3374, or filling out our online tip form at michigan.gov/clergy abuse. Now, we've asked the diocese to hold off on their own internal review process until our investigation can be concluded. And it's important for the public to know that this investigation is statewide. Priests have been moved from one diocese to the next, protecting the priests and the parish. And we're also going to be cooperating with other states, and I believe it's 12 other states, that now have similar ongoing investigations, because we know that there have been priests that have been moved from state to state to state. So this will be a cooperative effort. And what I would like to say to the public is this. If an investigator comes to your door and asks to speak with you, please ask to see their badge and not their rosary, okay? And here's why that matters. Because many churches and dioceses appear to be self-policing and encouraging parishioners to report abuse to them so they can conduct their own internal investigations. And so we've heard many stories from victims who've been encouraged to take settlements and sign NDAs, or non-disclosure agreements. And victims may believe that they cannot or should not report abuse to us because the church is going to handle it. And simply put, that's just not true. Firstly, if you signed an NDA, you still have a right, and I would say a responsibility, to speak to law enforcement authorities. An NDA will not protect the church. As we've seen, again, priests were moved from parish to parish and diocese to diocese, and that's why our statewide investigation is so critically important. We can and we will follow the trail of abuse where it's occurred. Now, the victims, many of whom were abused years ago and have silently lived with the pain, anguish, and emotional scars well into adulthood, deserve to be heard, and their abusers deserve to be brought to justice. The clergy abuse investigation is jarringly similar to the MSU investigation in that both institutions, when confronted with a public sex abuse scandal, publicly pledged their cooperation with law enforcement authorities, but have failed to deliver on those public promises. And regrettably, it would seem as though these two powerful institutions care more about protecting their brand than the people they serve. But if the Catholic Church really wants to stand up to its pledge to assist in our investigation, I would like to say this. Here's how they can actually help. Firstly, stop self-policing. Our office is conducting a thorough investigation, and it's important we be able to talk with any and all victims harmed by these egregious acts without the intervention of the church. Secondly, look, we may not be able to charge every priest, but our office will be sending letters to the diocese when we find credible allegations. And we ask that the diocese step up and, you know, deal with these abusers and protect people from them when the statute of limitations keeps us from being able to do that ourselves, which is often the case. Or, frankly, when there are other unethical acts that are uncovered and then we make the parish is aware of. And I know that just recently we had a number of cases where we saw acts that could not be charged criminally. Maybe they didn't rise to the level of criminal liability, but they were certainly incredibly unethical acts of priests who were in sexual relationships with the parishioners. And thirdly, work with our office to set up a fund for the victims that we can then administer so victims can get the help that they rightfully deserve for the trauma that they experienced under their watch. I should say the watch of the church. So, you know, unfortunately, I mean, the reality is there are predators in the priesthood that are still out there, and we feel as though they have to be stopped. And we need to ensure that this doesn't happen again and that bad actors are consistently held accountable, and also, frankly, it can lead to other changes in the law, such as mandatory reporting statutes that may be important through this investigation. So we're committed to releasing a final report at the end of this investigation so that everyone knows and understands what we've uncovered during the course of this lengthy investigation. So, and I will say that none of this investigation could have happened without the outstanding support and expertise of the Michigan State Police, and we are very grateful to them. And, of course, again, it's an honor to welcome Colonel Joe Gasper to speak about his role here. So why don't you come on up, Colonel, and say a few words.
Thank you, Attorney General Nessel. We appreciate your kind words and about the quality of our investigators and our investigations. We have some of the best detectives that MSP can offer assigned to both of these cases, and we're proud to partner with your office and be the finders of fact. I'd like to point out that although we have numerous investigators assigned, two of our lead investigators deserve a special note of attention, as they have led countless interviews and gone through countless pages of documents. One is First Lieutenant Lisa G. Cram, and the other is First Lieutenant Ryan Pinnell. Attorney General, as you noted, both of these cases are exceptionally complex and complicated. While we are committed to seeking justice for all the victims in the cases, we are also equally committed to ensuring that we conduct a thorough and proper investigation. We have high standards within the MSP, and I can assure you that we won't be cutting any corners and let you or the citizens of Michigan down. I also want to echo your comments regarding the importance of reporting tips directly to law enforcement. We take all leads seriously, and it's critically important that we hear directly from you when you have information to provide. Again, I thank you for your support and partnership for making these investigations a priority for not only the State Police and the Attorney General, but also for the citizens of Michigan and particularly the victims. Thank you.
All right, thank you, Colonel. And again, appreciate everything that you and your team are doing, both on the MSU investigation and also on the Catholic Church clergy abuse investigation. So finally, I'd like to give a shout out to one of your colleagues in the media, who I think has done a tremendous service to this state. So I'd like to personally, on behalf of this office, thank Ken Kolker of Wood TV, who I see back there. Honestly, I think you did a fantastic job of shining light on the clergy abuse happening in the Grand Rapids area. I think it was an incredibly important series that you did. And I will tell you, we received at least a couple dozen tips as a result of that, so, you know, some of which we're investigating immediately. So I would say this, you know, I know obviously that Ken put a tremendous amount of work into that, but, you know, what I'd ask all of you in the media is cover this story, you know, cover this story, talk about what's happened, and tell people, please, about our tip line and our website, because that's really the most important way that we're going to make certain that we can fully investigate every incident of abuse, is by having people know that there's somebody here who cares, and that, you know, I have a whole, you know, team of people here that are working on these issues. So anyway, thanks again, Ken. So my challenge is to all of you, though, to stay on top of this and to allow us to continue the investigation and to sort of be an active participant and to assist us with that. So anyway, before I wrap things up here and get to your many, many, many questions, I really want to take a minute to recognize our incredible team of career prosecutors and investigators who've worked tirelessly on all of these cases to seek justice for the people that we serve on what, you know, all three of these, such critically important cases involving so many people in our state. So if you don't mind, I'd like to acknowledge them one by one. Our chief of staff, Laura Moody. Turn around, wave. There you go. Good. Excellent. Assistant Attorney General Christina Grassi. No, see, so you have to turn around, wave. Assistant Attorney General Michelle Bry. Our chief investigator, David Dwyer. Where are you, Dave? Oh, there he is. Assistant Attorney General Brian Colosier. And, of course, again, we welcome our new Assistant Attorney General, Danielle Hageman-Clark. Welcome. With that, I guess this is the fun part, huh? Colonel Gasper has to leave in a few minutes. So if you have any questions for the Colonel, I think we should start with him because he's got to go. So does anybody have any questions for Colonel Gasper? Yes? Now I'm just going to run away now at this point.
So. Right. I would like to follow the Attorney General's lead, too, and announce that this will be my first and last press conference during my tenure. So. Yes, we had the execution of the search warrants were by investigators throughout the state, and they were on premises to seize the material themselves. Yes?
So did you seize material from the secret archives of each diocese?
Yes, sir.
Will your investigation include pursuing people who are not victims, but, for example, the PR people in the various departments who seemed to be involved in the obstruction of justice when people wanted to know what was happening in regards to some particular complaint about a known predator priest? They took extreme measures to try to prevent the media, especially from understanding what was going on. Perhaps obstruction of justice might cover some of that. So are non-victims included in what you're doing?
Well, I think that from a standpoint of the investigation, what's important is that we let the investigation take its course. We allow the investigators to interview as many people that we can identify to make sure that we're handling that situation and others accordingly. Yes, sir.
Might not look great with elderly priests in handcuffs. Does that make a difference to go after the elderly patients?
Well, from a standpoint of the statute of limitations, again, the investigation, if a criminal act was committed, then it'll be prosecuted. From a standpoint of the age, I guess I would say that I'm probably a little more concerned about the victims than I am about the suspects.
Are you getting any of those tips since 1995? Are you actively looking at them?
I'm not familiar with the specific dates on the tips, but we do have a number of tips that have both been assigned out and are being looked at.
What would that fall within that schedule?
Yes, sir.
Colonel, if you don't mind, we can have our prosecutor answer some of that, because I think I'll have you a whole lot of questions about statute of limitations. Brian, why don't you take it from here real quick?
Okay. And so, as it relates to the statute of limitations, that's a very, very broad question. We can't confine it to a specific decade or a specific year. Each case has to be analyzed factually, in depth, and with due diligence, and our team is doing that exhaustively. It's very important that the people of the state of Michigan understand that if you are a survivor or witnessed sexual abuse by the clergy, don't put a time limit on it. We want to hear from you. We care. And even if your case can't be prosecuted, you still might be able to help in the prosecution of other cases.
The reason I'm asking, I've got a 12-year-old who was responded by a priest in 1990. He wants to know, is that a case that can be prosecuted?
It would be irresponsible for me to analyze that here based on just those facts. It is possible. Thank you.
Does anybody have anything else for Colonel Gasper?
Yes.
In terms of, I know Attorney General Nelson mentioned earlier that the Catholic Church is trying to self-police this. Is this from reports you're getting from victims, or is this like documentation that you're seeing from the church going out to people?
Yes, it's primarily through the interview of people that are involved, that there are some parallel investigations that are going on. Yes, sir. From the state police perspective, the diocese align with our districts, and so we have assigned by district. Yes, sir.
Have you identified any new perpetrators who have not been identified by the diocese or your agency or any other police agency? That's number one. And number two, if you have, when would you anticipate that you would prosecute?
Again, those are pretty specific questions that, based on the fact that we've got an ongoing investigation, I would probably refrain from commenting on those. Thank you. Yes, sir.
I've got a victim who just actually texted me wondering if the state is looking at changing the statute of limitations to prosecute school districts as other states have done.
That would not necessarily be a question for the state police, as we are the finders of fact in this particular case, and as a matter of what our scope is, we would definitely entertain discussions with those who create law within the state to do our part in conversation with that. No, sir, we are not in that area. Yes, ma'am.
Do you have a number or a guesstimate of how many victims have come forward, how many cases you're looking at?
There are a number. It's a high number.
Like 100?
I don't have the specific number.
I mean, we have 300 tips so far. They're clearly not all victims or survivors.
I don't have firsthand information of the tips.
Colonel, I think that's all the time we have for your questions.
I'm sorry, but I can take one more, ma'am. I'm sorry.
Sorry. Has the diocese, any churches that you've been going to, have they been blocked from
The level of cooperation, as Attorney General Nessel pointed out, it varies, but what's important is that from a standpoint of the investigation that the two agencies are undergoing, it's important that takes priority over any type of parallel investigation. So,
certain question. So, any for the election, but during the transition, I was not engaged in any conversations at all personally with Todd Flood. And I did that intentionally because I wanted to preserve the conflict wall and I didn't want to compromise it in any way. So, a lot of the details, I was not, well, really almost any of those details, I was not involved in, and intentionally so. But I'm going to allow Solicitor General Hamoud to field any questions that you have about the criminal side of the Flint cases, please. You know, at this point in time, like I stated, we are in the process of reviewing every piece of evidence that has been provided in this case. As some of you know, and I'm sure all of you know, this is a 3-year investigation. Building a team right now, there are over 4 million documents, along with other pieces of evidence associated with this case. I think it would be premature of me to say who is going to be interviewed and who's not. I think our work right now is to make sure we do our due diligence in that regard, with no preconceived notions again, only that the people of Flint were wronged. And we will... Anybody who we as a team believe is criminally responsible in this case or should be interviewed will be interviewed with no specific names. As you know, no one is above the law, and every single aspect of this case will be investigated, and we will do all the interviews necessary if need be.
By growing the team, does this mean that more charges will be brought against individuals formerly state government in this case?
And again, I think that it's premature to answer that now. If more charges need to be brought, then we will bring them. I think putting the team together, we are evaluating all the evidence that is involved. As you know, there are many victims in this case, and many pieces that originally Attorney General Nessel's administration was not a part of. Now that we've stepped in, and what we are doing right now is doing our due diligence in order to answer those questions and get the answers.
Seven people have taken the earlier question about
are those serving their purpose? I know that, you know, that came with the understanding that they would help strengthen the cases against other people already charged.
That was not something that I had said, right? Again, we recently stepped in. So because it was not my decision, I can't comment on that right now, but we shall see.
Do you agree with the plea deals?
At this point in time, I will not comment on that, but I will tell you that I am at ease that our office stepped in. And I am at ease that we are building a strong team.
At any point, did you consider dropping the charges against Mr. Lyons and Dr. Lyons?
You know, Mr. Lyons and Dr. Wells obviously had preliminary examinations in this case. We are still reviewing months and months of examination. Again, as I stated, over 4 million pages of document with 3-year investigation in this case. The people of Flint deserve for us to take our time in terms of evaluating every piece of evidence before we consider anything. And we will be looking at every single person that has been charged and, you know, any potential person that may be charged. We will be guided by the evidence that has been presented and following the lead of our investigators in this case.
Not considered, even thought about,
The only thing we've considered right now is doing our all to make sure that justice is ensured in this case. We have not considered that. I can't say anything is off the table, and I can't say anything is on the table right now. So, as we stated, there was a different role prior to Attorney General Nestle's administration taking over, and that was that this office had allocated the resources associated that were supposed to be given to the Flint water crisis prosecutions and investigations that was given to flood law, in which a firm was hired to prosecute this case. The role is different now because we are the firm that will be bringing people on board, deciding who will be valuable to the team. As you know, Todd Flood has been on the team since the inception, definitely has institutional knowledge. One of your questions you asked, some of these people have been given plea deals. Those plea deals were also given by attorney Todd Flood. I do think he is committed to this case. I do think that there are people on his team that have worked very hard with dedication to this case, and I look forward to him joining the team, that we are currently assembling, and hopefully we will have more information on that in the future, where we are planning on having a press conference to be able, we would be better equipped then to answer these specific questions.
Does that mean that he will still lead the team and that he'll report directly to you? How is that going to play out?
The person that will lead this team is the person that our attorney general appointed, and that is myself. And today I announced to you that I will be working jointly with Prosecutor Kim Worthy, which I had the opportunity to learn from and fight for justice under her wing. So I'm excited for that. Those are the leaders. But the people that will lead this team, though, it's going to be corroboration with everybody. But I want to make it clear that it is this office that will be held accountable. This is a public case, a public health crisis, and this office stepped up to the plate. And I'm excited that Prosecutor Kim Worthy has decided to step up to the plate as well.
And how will he be compensated? What's the salary going to be since he was on a contractual basis?
We are working on a contract. I can tell you that. At the end of the day, he will be compensated like any special attorney, assistant attorney general will be compensated, not a blank check. And we will be fully in charge of the finances and the allocation of resources from now on.
Will he be allowed to do outside work?
We are still in the process of figuring that out now that the contract is changing. So we'll have more information on that.
Do you plan these cases moving forward as scheduled? I mean, we've seen them, like you said, go on for a couple of years now. Can we expect maybe a speedier process?
So I'll tell you this. Some cases will have to be adjourned. We might have to take different routes, right? I think when we talk about speed after a 3-year investigation, I am not the person that would put a time limit or say, let's speed up this process. We will work diligently to make sure that all the resources are spent where they're supposed to be spent, and that is to make sure that we ensure justice for the people of Flint. So it will be a very diligent process, and I'm confident that we will see that day.
Solicitor General,
yes.
This sounds and feels like a complete restart of those 3 years after the fact. You're saying now that some cases will have to be adjourned, you have to take different routes, you're changing management. I mean, what's your overall assessment of the job that Todd Flood and the team did to date? And are all these charges appropriate? Is it appropriate to charge all these people with manslaughter?
So I would disagree with the statement that it's a complete restart. I think that that was one of the considerations, one of the things that I took into consideration moving forward, that there have been people that have worked diligently on the case, Todd Flood and others,
There were resources spent on the investigation. And at this point in time, I think it's appropriate for us to look at the investigation and everything that was associated with it. We're not throwing everything out and starting from zero. If that was the case, I wouldn't have made some of the decisions that I made. So no, I think it's important to have that institutional knowledge. I think that his role and others' role is going to be valuable to this team. And I appreciate the work that has been put forward. There is, this is in no way, we have to start over. But there's a new leadership. And I think that as attorneys and as career prosecutors, we know that we don't just jump into a case and say, all right, this is the file, and I trust that everybody did their due diligence. There was a lot of people that were involved in this case, not just the attorneys that are on the case now. And I think it's only appropriate that we evaluate that. So if there are some adjournments or if we decide as a team other things have to happen, I assure you that they will be done with due diligence and by taking into consideration all of the evidence involved. And the people that were on the original team will have a say in that as well. And this will be, and one of them being Todd Flood. So this will be a team effort. So that is up on the 25th. And I did speak with the defense attorneys on that case. And we are trying to seek an adjournment on that case. And I think they were expecting that, just to give us some time. This is the people's firm. And the people's firm should have stepped up to the plate. And that is my belief. And that is exactly why that was the first thing our attorney general did when she took office here as well. When you represent the people, you stand for the people. This, I'm not going to comment. Maybe they had different circumstances or whatnot. It's certainly not the way that this administration, I can confidently say, would have done things under the leadership of Attorney General Nestle. We are in the... So this is a contract that, of course, was authorized to him by the Attorney General, the previous Attorney General, Bill Schuette. But we have the power to do with that contract as we please and as we see fit, as we see right.
Have you been to Flint, met with the people of Flint, and is that influencing, I guess, at all, kind of your role?
I think... that is one of the most important questions. I am in the process, like I said, of meeting with victims. There are many victims, and I will not be able to meet with every single one of them because I think everybody in Flint has been affected. But we are in the process of doing that and meeting with stakeholders, community stakeholders, community leaders, and I will be doing that for the upcoming weeks. I'm sorry, but thank you all for being here.
Thanks, Barbara. Thank you. Okay.
I would say any and all potential crimes are being investigated. So I don't think there's going to be anything off the table with that. I don't have a firm number right now on the number of potential victims. I know we've heard a lot of different things. Obviously, this office was not handling that investigation before, so we're publicly announcing that we're going to be handling it now, of course. And again, we welcome information from anybody that has information about John Gettert, and those tips will be followed up on and will be thoroughly investigated.
Very important case. I know
way these cases have been handled, right? It was bizarre to me that you would farm out some of the biggest prosecutions that we've ever had in the history of this state to a private firm with virtually no oversight by the Office of Michigan Attorney General, who was ostensibly authorizing those cases. And that bothered me a lot. There is really no one that I respect more than Prosecutor Kim Worthy when it comes to her integrity, and particularly complex cases that involve matters of public integrity. I think she's really shown herself to be someone who, you know, I'd say she's completely unafraid to do the right thing. She's not bound by politics. There is no one that she is afraid to charge, but she's also not afraid to deny a warrant. You know, and I've seen many controversial cases where maybe it wasn't the politically popular thing to do, but it was the right thing to do. I have to pick side here. Mood was going to be on the cases, and with Kim Worthy working with her, I could feel incredibly confident and know that I could step away from the criminal cases, not be involved in those at all, but that they would still be handled properly. That was the most important thing in my mind, and it was a commitment that I made to the residents of Flint when I ran for office. And I think between Fadwa Hamoud and her work with Kim Worthy, I think that this is going to be a trustworthy process. So whatever happens on those cases, people can trust that, you know, those cases were dictated by the evidence and the law and not by political interests. And that's what I wanted to see. And I know with Kim and Fadwa handling those cases, that's what we're going to get. So we're thinking in the neighborhood of about 2 years because, I mean, again, hundreds and thousands of documents. And, you know, we could ultimately be over 1,000 victims in this case. So this is going to be a lengthy investigation. Now, how we've decided to proceed is, you know, firstly, in terms of prioritizing, if there are priests that are still working with children, with vulnerable adults, we want to get on those cases right away. We want to make sure our first priority is that there be no continued victimization. And so we're going to get on those cases first. Secondly, cases that are within the statute of limitations, because every day that goes by is a day that the statute is tolling, right? So we want to make certain that we handle those cases as quickly as possible as well. In terms of where they're going to be handled, generally speaking, they'll be handled in the counties in which the crimes occurred. From a jurisdiction standpoint. But again, we have statewide jurisdiction, so we have the authority through statute to prosecute cases in any county in this state. And again, if we find out that a priest has been transferred to another state, then we'll be working cooperatively with the attorneys general in those states and to make certain that they have that information so that there's no continued victimization by somebody who is still allowed to be a member of the priesthood.
Can you talk about the decision to take over the Getter investigation? I know that it's been going on for a year in Eaton County. Does it have anything to do with the fact that parents of gymnasts have called the Attorney General's office frustrated with the way that Eaton County has been handling the investigation?
So I will say this. We had a lengthy conversation with Eaton County Prosecutor Doug Lloyd. I have a lot of respect for Prosecutor Lloyd and his staff, and I am convinced that he did everything in his power to properly investigate this case. But, you know, there was a bond, I feel, that was formed between a lot of these same victims and the staff in this office. And so it became clear, I think, to both of us that, firstly, the fact that we did have statewide jurisdiction and there were potential jurisdictional issues involved, and the fact that a lot of the victims just really trusted this office and some of the assistant AGs that have worked here, that, you know, they felt as though we might get more information and people might feel more willing to come forward if the cases were handled by this office. And the other issue, quite honestly, is a resource issue. When I talked to Prosecutor Lloyd, you know, they were simply overwhelmed. There's a number of homicide cases that they're currently handling in Eaton County, and they have a limited number of prosecutors. I want to say, was it 11 APAs that they have? Well, the prosecutor plus 10 APAs. I think they have 11 APAs, assistant prosecuting attorneys, in Eaton County. At last count, we had 278 attorneys working at our office. And, of course, that doesn't include our investigators. So the fact of the matter is, when you have a case that you believe is invalid,